This podcast is sponsored by Utocorp. For more details, please click on the link that is in the description below. Welcome to episode 20 of on a not yet. Welcome to episode 20 of on a personal note with Adarsh Sakre. Today we have another amazing guest in the studio. Before we speak about him, let's say hi to Suhas.
Hi.
Very tough to say that formally.
No. I killed the other guest. He's not coming. I'm your main guest for the evening. Fuck that guy. I'm the shit.
You're the main shit.
I'm the shit. Yeah.
So before we start off with this episode, today we have Suhas Navaratna in the studio. And today is the first time that, a guest asked me, bro, can we drink on the shoot? And I'm like, finally. After 20 episodes, cheers, bro. Cheers. After 20 episodes, there's a guest that was ready to have a drink with me on the studio. So that's special about today.
I'm so happy that I made your dream come true. You were more excited about this than me.
No, that's the thing, right? Like, we've always had Bose in the studio and, the glasses. The first thing he says, dude, you're such a professional drinker. I'm like...
Show them that. He has this in his studio.
So we have it here, but it's the first time it's being used on camera. So cheers to that. Also, do share your old monk on stage story. Let's start with that.
Oh, yeah. So everyone who knows me, even for like a short period of time, knows that I drink like a fish. So okay. It's like, I remember it was like we even do a show called Alcoholics Atrocious, which is like...
Alcoholics?
Me and my friend Suman.
Okay.
We do a show called Alcoholics Atrocious, which is just an evening where we only tell you how we fucked up when we got drunk. Okay. All the shit that we've done. Like I've like slept under a lorry. I've like, been in a police station for the entire night because I got caught drunk driving. Do not drink and drive. But yeah, I was stupid back then. And all these shit anyway. But so a friend of mine, Akshay, who was like supposed to call me up on stage after his set, he said, please welcome on stage old monk Abhimani Suhas Navaratna. And we put that video out and we had like shared like a reel, and Old Monk, the Instagram page, actually shared it. So I consider that like an achievement.
Like an achievement.
In life, yes.
Like you should have like an Old Monk medal on you.
Yes. I don't want any medals, just give me free booze.
So there you go, Old Monk, if you're listening. that's the request. My throat's a little screwed. And you might say, then why the fuck are you drinking? But that's what it is.
Yeah, sometimes you have to fuck shit up in order to make your dreams come true. And now that it is, so enjoy, live in the moment.
Enjoy and live in the moment. Yeah. So a little background about, what the fuck Suhas does. he's a writer. He's been a writer on a few of the popular shows, right from Family Man to... Tarle Box videos to a latest movie that's coming out along with Danish Seth. It's called One Cut, Two Cut. And not just that, known big on the comedy scene, especially regionally. His videos, his shows are something that the Bangalore crowd really enjoys. So if you've not gone for a Suhas show before, you should definitely go. And of course, he's done a little bit of acting here and there. Not much.
Not much, yeah.
Not much, but you never know. You never know what happens in the future.
Hey man, any offers you're willing to do, you can call me.
So that's harsh for you. We'll definitely get to know about
it. It's like how they say, no, like if they come and say, what do you do? And I'll be like, so I'm a writer, okay. I'm a stand-up comedian, and I act in films. I'm ruining three art forms at the same time. Like,
no, man, come on, come on. I think he spent a lot of years in this. And of course, there's a story behind it, which is what we'll kind of dive into today. So welcome to episode 20. Yes, Suhas. The first thing that's coming to my mind is, of course, the number of years you've spent with this, right? So after spending so many years, how do you feel today?
You mean my profession?
Yeah, your profession. Like, how, what does it feel like today, man, being Suhas?
It's still, nothing seems to have changed as such. Okay. Like, the size of the audience has changed. But life-wise, it's still the same, man.
Okay.
Like, I don't think, because I've been doing this for, like, long enough. Like, I think this is this December I complete 7 years in comedy.
Okay.
And it was rough, dude. Like, you won't believe it, I used to be thin and my hair was all jet black.
That's crazy.
It was like really fucked up. And I also sort of, you know, like, I'm one of these guys who can only focus on one thing at a time. Like, you know, I can never multitask.
Okay.
And like, for example, a lot of comedians, they have a job and they do stand-up.
Okay.
And a lot of people, you know, they're in college, they're able to study and do stand-up and all of that. I could never do that. Like, if I'm focusing on something, it's always been just that. And so I sort of pushed myself into a corner wherein I was like, I gave myself no other option but to do this. So when I dropped out, I had no degree, impossible to get a job. So I made sure that all the other doors are closed and there's only one door. This better work, otherwise I'm fucked. So it's like, you just, I think that was the one good thing I did in my life till today. But yeah, nothing much has changed, dude.
Okay.
Lord, you go home to the same parents and they still tell you that you're a piece of shit for not having like a 9-to-5 job and like not earning like a monthly salary. My mother, till to this day, when someone asks her, what does your son do? She's just heard the word writer. So for her, conceptually, she doesn't understand it. So she'll be like, oh, na, post office ko letter bari tane. I've written for Family Man season 2. Post office, you write letter, no? What does that mean? How is that a profession? You know, like, who is this chooth who's in the post office just writing random letters? Like, not even for someone, just like every day goes to the post office, writes a letter.
Is that her real idea of being a writer?
Yeah, in her head, it's just that. So there's absolutely zero.
How fucked up is that?
It's very fucked up because there's absolutely zero respect, right? Like, what does your husband do? Mm. Oh, he works in railways as like a supervisor. What does your son do? Your post office letter.
Okay, so that's pretty much been the situation.
Everywhere, and you know, like, it's nice. It's like those small mini vacations that you have when you're doing a show, right? Like, you meet people, they're like, we love that's you. Let's take a selfie. One guy even took a selfie while I was at a urinal, like,
no shit. Okay.
Like, I'm like covering my dick. I'm like, I don't want this out on the internet. Because, you know, people compare. Right? Like,
oh man.
Yeah, like, they'll look at the dick and be like, his face and dick same. My pubes are also grey.
Oh man, Suhas.
Do we cross the line?
No, not did yet. We cross the line? Not yet.
Shatta is also grey.
Oh man. So Suhas, when you
believe I just said that on camera.
That's okay, dude. That's okay. So let's jump right in to one of the things you really enjoy the most, and that's writing.
Yeah.
Right. So Yeah, let's talk about it. How did you become a writer? How did all these big names like Family Man get attached to Suhas? And why are they working with you?
No, it was actually very... I never knew. Like, I also worked as a writer for TVF, The Viral Fever, when they opened their place in Bangalore. So I had some writing experience. Mm-hmm. But I used to do... If you've seen my comedy, you will... realize that most of my jokes are storytelling. Okay. So it's not like, oh, there's a setup, premise, punchline, like boom, 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 nothing. I generally would tell a story, a funny story. Mm-hmm. You know, like, I wouldn't say things that are funny, I would say stuff funny.
Okay.
Like, there's a distinction.
There is, I get it.
Right.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
So I remember at that point, the Family Man main writer, Suman Kumar, he also started doing stand-up.
Oh, lovely. Does he still do?
He still does.
Okay,
it.
Lovely.
And we became friends, and because he also is like old monk Abhimani. And we would just drink together, we would hang out together, and I would tell him the shows that I would watch and everything. And he noticed something, which was that, dude, all the stuff that you do on stage is storytelling. Like, you know how to make a story interesting, you know exactly where to cut the tension and add a joke, you know, how to build it up, you know, all of that, all of that shit, which generally means that you can write.
Okay.
Makes like sense. If I give you like a story and I'm saying script this, you can easily do it purely because you understand the beats.
Yeah.
You understand how to tell a story.
Mm-hmm.
So one day randomly we were drinking and he just said, so do you want to work on it? Do you want to come work for Family? Oh.
Yeah,
I'm a little, let's go. I had no idea that I've even said yes.
Oh shit, you were drunk.
I was drunk, I've forgotten about it. And then like, after like 2 or 3 days, he calls me and he's like, huh, so pack your bags, are you ready? I'm like, ready for what? And he's like, Lord, I told you, we're working together. I'm like, oh, okay. And like, within like you know, like a day, like I'm in Bombay, I'm sitting with Raj and DK, who have like worked on films like Go Go Agon, 99,
Super
Stri, all this shit. Like, I'm in a room with them.
Damn cool.
And we're already starting to write. It was fucking intimidating, dude.
When was this, timeline wise?
About 2 years ago. Two and a half years ago, I'm guessing. And it was fucking intimidating. Like, and there's also something that I wanted to tell people, that show business is so small, right? Like, the bubble is very small. So it's like, when you get into any kind of art or show business, the chances of you meeting and like drifting into another sphere is very easy.
Yeah, okay.
Like, I used to watch TVF videos and I'd be like, hey man, like, I like these guys. Then suddenly out of nowhere, they've flown me to Bombay and I'm meeting the head guy of TVF, and I'm like rubbing shoulders with like all the actors that I had admired and everything.
Only shoulders?
I would. The thing is, I tried.
Didn't happen.
But please don't hashtag me too me.
I am
a very good boy. I have never done anything to make women uncomfortable. I'll tell you later. But yeah. So it's very easy. And suddenly it was just that. We got in. And it was like such a thrill to like see your name come up there.
Of course.
You know, it's like.
Yeah.
It was just that. And after Family Man, I think now it's like. You know, it just opened so many doors. Right? Like. All of a sudden, like now, if I'm getting like offers from people, they're calling me.
Was it good
like
money?
Really good money.
Yeah.
When compared to stand up, definitely, yes.
Pays for quite a few months.
Paid for a year.
Yeah? Fuck.
It was like, I was set for a year because
that's
of that.
Huge.
It was like so. Like, dude, paid off all my debts. Like, I had like
cheers
so
that,
many debts.
Cheers to that.
It's so much debts, and then suddenly it's like, you know, because you're
Yeah.
You've taken like a unconventional job, but all your friends have not, right? So they'll call you like, "Macha, come, we'll hang out, duh." And I'm like, "Lauda, I don't have anything." They're like, no, you come, we will cover for you. And they'll make it obvious also. You know, they want to rub it in your face you're a, you don't have any money, you're a broke fuck. Like when the bill comes, I've already told them I don't have money, but when the bill comes, they'll be like, "I think 600 is your share."
It's okay.
Could have just already paid the fucking bill.
Then
like fucking going there to the same table with those same chutes and like taking out like, "Guys, I've got this," and like doing that. Boom,
yeah. Man. How did they take it? How did they react that time?
I expected more.
They were like,
"Oh, wow, family man writer now, no? Yeah, you only pay." Like,
I was just asking you, like, when, you know, an independent artist gets attached to a big name, do we have space for negotiation? Or is it like, give you a rate and you have to accept it? And how do they decide the rate?
Dude, when something comes your way and it is already like, I wrote for season 2, right?
Yeah.
And at that point, season 1 had become such a massive hit.
Mm.
And when you get an opportunity to get onto such a project, they'll be like, "We're going to pay." I'm like, "Whatever you pay me is fine.
I am doing this.
Please, please.
But is that the objective then? Is that the objective to get
talent? It's like trying to get your foot in the door.
Okay.
Right? Like, when you... You don't start off by asking like...
Oh, no, I'm saying from the company, right? From the show. Are the shows planning it in such a way that we get artists who will say yes, no matter what?
I'm just trying to see where's that line. I think it mainly had a lot to do with the fact that Raj and DK are, and Suman Kumar, they are open to... new talent
exploring,
you know, like they came for, they even came for our stand-up shows just to see how I am, and like what kind of content do I do and all that. So they are very open to hiring new talent and new new people, but generally it's not the case if you go to Bombay.
So I might sound a little amateur with my questions, don't mind it, of course. Like, so when we say writer, now you say you wrote for Family Man. What are you actually writing for them? Are you writing the story? Are you writing the dialogues? And yeah, that's one more thing.
All of it.
Okay.
So it starts from basic conceptualization.
Like, okay.
Like, you know, like, okay, so now we're going to talk about this. This is our central premise. And you build the story around it. Suman already had that central premise. He was like, "Okay, I want to talk about this." And then we actually sat and we... like did like episode breakdowns. Okay, so in this episode this is going to happen, this episode this is going to happen, and then you go on to write a thing called a series bible.
Series bible.
Which is like a rough summary of every scene in the episode.
Okay.
And that needs to get approved. That takes like one
who
or
approves
two drafts.
That
first Raj and DK has to approve. And they also add their inputs and they also write a few scenes in. And then Amazon has to approve it. Then it comes back with, they will recommend some changes.
Changes and all
first
of that.
First draft, second draft, third draft happens. And then they commission you to write the screenplay.
Okay, okay.
And then you have to start writing the screenplay with dialogues, with this, with that. So it's a huge process. And it is really good to follow this process purely because... you have time. They don't come at you going like, you know, "We want this in 2 months."
You have time.
It's like 6-7 months of like grinding it out. You know, it's never like 30. Like, and they're very open, dude. Like, I still remember this.
Okay.
There's this character in the show. He's supposed to be the national security advisor.
Okay.
And he's sitting with the Prime Minister, and we were talking, and Suman had written like a paragraph, which was like, "And then a piping hot cup of tea is placed in front of this gentleman, And he's described the tea so well for a paragraph, right? My mouth started drooling after that. So I just looked at him and I'm like, can we actually go get some tea?
Okay.
The guy was like, we're working, man. We'll go later.
He's like, I can work.
I'm like, if I can't have tea, then this character can also not have tea.
No.
And it was done the entire season.
Okay.
They all laughed and they were like, that's a good joke. And we just sat down. The national security advisor always sits and tries to have tea, but never gets to have tea for the entire season.
Like, oh, shit.
Like, if you've watched it, you can clearly see, like...
I watched season one. Season two, I haven't
watched. Yeah, he'll take, like, a teapot and he'll do this, there's no tea. Or he'll be, like, about to drink something and then someone will come and be like, sir, please come. And he's like, oh, shit. And, like...
Ah, I really like this.
He never gets to drink tea. So, just shit like this. Small stuff like this, I would, like, say, and they would, like, it's great, let's do it. Like, you know, I think... That is their strong point, Suman and Raj and DK. They're able to like pick a joke.
Pick up that and
let's roll with it.
How did it feel? So does it feel great while you're working there? Or does it feel great when it's released and your friends are like, fuck.
No. And you're working there, no?
How does it feel?
It's a different feeling because for me, the first time I sat in that room, it was like a learning opportunity. You know, it was, I've never written anything before on that grander scale. And just to see these people
work
like that, it was amazing. So I was just like sitting there like a student too. Then at night I would get grilled by someone.
Yeah.
He'd be like, Loda, can you apply some thought? What is wrong with you? Like, all that is there, but I learned so much from just sitting in that room.
What do they have? Hearing them. What do they have that you didn't?
Like the concept of like staging a scene.
Okay.
Like for example, let's say it's an exercise. Let's see if you can try it. Okay,
let's do it.
So there's a husband and a wife.
Okay.
They're about to have a divorce.
Okay.
They're meeting at a restaurant. How would you write the scene? How would you start the scene?
Husband and wife meeting at a restaurant. They are going to discuss the divorce.
Yes.
Okay.
They're about to break up. How would you start the scene?
So just describe how that scene will play out. Okay. So most probably the way I see it is the woman is annoyed. So she's not looking at the guy. The guy is confused. The guy is confused. He still doesn't know what's going on, how he's landed up here, how did the marriage like come to this point.
How are you going to show all this? Because on screenplay, there's no thought.
Okay.
Right, it has to be very subtle.
Okay.
Like you're saying, she's not looking at him.
Yeah.
That was good.
Yeah.
Right, she's like looking to the side and he's like there, like you're showing some frustration.
Yeah.
So usually what people would do, like a first time writer will be like, he got up, he wore like a shirt, he looked at himself in the mirror and he's like, I'm gonna do it today. And then they go, they show like him driving and then they reach the restaurant, they sit and they talk.
Okay.
Very simple rule is, why the fuck did you have to show him wake up?
Okay.
Why the fuck did you have to show him get ready?
Not required.
Why the fuck did you have to show him drive?
What
is the scene? The scene is them breaking up. So why don't you start the scene with this guy looking at her saying, it's not working, babe.
Yeah.
Like you've cut to the chase.
Yeah.
Right? Like, so like for example, this is like a screenplay 101 rule, which is enter late, exit early.
Enter late, exit?
Early.
Enter late. Oh yeah, makes sense.
So it's like now that it's done, I don't have to stay there in that scene. Right?
Yeah.
It's over. It's fuck off.
Yeah.
Why will I show them pay the bill?
Not required.
Tata bye bye.
No one gives a fuck about that.
No, but is it important?
Okay.
Right? Like for example, I could twist it in such a way like, he gets up, he's getting ready. He takes a gun and he puts it in his back pocket. And now he's going to the restaurant and he sits in front of her. So now there's a gun.
Yeah.
So you're thinking, oh fuck, shit's going to go down now. He might kill her.
Hmm.
So it's like shit like this, you know, like how do you stage
so that's
it?
The difference.
How do you say it?
So can I say it's more professional?
It is professional.
Is it more experienced?
It is like...
I think it's experience.
It is experience, and at the same time, you know, they have directed so many movies, and even Suman has written quite a lot for his in his career. So it's like, it comes with both, I feel. A technical understanding is very important when you're writing a screenplay. Like using sounds.
Yeah.
Like people generally don't write sounds.
Yeah.
Or people generally don't. Indian media is very heavy on dialogue.
Okay.
Like, for example, there's a scene in Family Man Season 1 where now I have to establish to you that the viewer, that Shrikant Tiwari lies to his wife. Now, how do I establish it without telling it?
Okay. What exactly happened? Like, how did you all end up showing it?
They get up, he's wearing his shirt, and she goes, Shrikant, tumne wo tablet kha liya? Haan, haan, maine kha liya. And then he takes the thing and he pops it. So it's like the very first time you've seen Shrikant Tiwari on screen, he's lied to his wife.
Nice.
So it is already established his character with that one instance.
Very interesting.
So it's like that, you know, like just figuring it out. Like,
damn nice.
Yeah.
How's now?
I can't believe I got so technical.
No, it's good. I loved it. I mean, you know, not everyone.
I could see you almost falling asleep.
So, man, I'm a sucker for this.
Let's talk about sex. So, what is your favorite position?
We'll get to that. What about one cut, two cut, and you know?
Oh, that was. It's. I think it. Like I told you, show business is so small. Right, you meet people. Like there's another stand-up comedian friend of mine called Vamsidhar Bhogaraju.
Okay.
And he technically...
Vamsi. How are you?
Hey, Vamsi. Like, shit, no.
No getting distracted to us. Yeah. You're still on your first drink.
Let's change that.
Oh, shit. I shouldn't have said that. I'll make your drink. Tell us about one cut, two cut.
I think Vamsi was also a stand-up comedian.
Okay.
He still is. And we just... So we did a show on Tarle Box, a web series called Cabaret.
Okay.
And he acted in that in one of the roles.
Okay.
And it was the last day of shoot and there was like a wrap-up party happening. Fuck, everything somehow or the other ends up with alcohol only. So there's a wrap-up party happening and we're all drinking.
Sure.
And he's talking to another actor called Soundarya who's played a role in the web series. He's like, so the movie is happening. Can you like come? Do you know how to drive? All that, because the character has to drive and all that. I just walk up to him with my drink and I'm like, what the fuck are you guys talking about? Like, oh, I'm directing a movie and like I want Soundarya to act in it.
Oh shit.
I'm like, what? I thought we were friends for so long. You never asked me. The guy just looked at me and said, what, do you want to act? I'm like, yeah. He's like, okay, done. Fucking he changed the script.
Okay.
And he wrote a role to incorporate me in.
Are you serious?
And he was like, why, come and act now.
Man,
I was
that's
under
real.
Puneet Rajkumar Productions, dude.
Yeah,
and
respect to him.
Really, like, it was like we met him on the last day of shoot. He was one of the kindest people that I've met. Like, you know, I'm a nobody. Like,
yeah,
he could have easily just walked past me like this without like a glance, but he's like, hi. Like, shakes your hand and he's like, I've seen the movie. I saw your role. You've done very well. You know, the amount of attention the guy gives you and everything, and the freedom to experiment.
Yeah.
Right? Like,
nice.
He's not one of those guys who's like, I'll make like a massy movie and everything. Oh. He wanted to give new talent chances. He wanted the industry to grow and shit like that. You know, like,
kudos to
the guy,
man.
Yeah, like, he was and is going to be like...
Forever. Else. And when does this movie come out?
Hopefully, Christmas.
Christmas?
On
okay.
Amazon Prime.
Let's hope for the best.
I hope so. Don't hold me up to it.
Don't hold you up to it. Great, man. You know, this is definitely something that, I mean, you should be proud of. It's not easy to get into these places. Now, kind of jumping the boat the gun, a little. Jumping into another boat. I wanted to talk about your tattoo that. can we show it to them? Like,
yeah, can you blur the name?
let's blur the name if you
I
can.
I don't want the person to get angry with
me. Sure, Mr. Vinay, if you'll be listening to this, please edit it out.
Please, Vinay. I've had enough trauma in my life. I don't want more.
So first of all, you told me that the name on your hand is the X to the X. Yeah. And then you had a breakup recently, right? So, yeah, fucking let's talk about that.
Very heavy breakup.
What day was it? Tell me the day you got that on your tattoo. What was running in your mind?
I was 17 or 18.
Oh, fuck. That's early.
Very early.
How old are you now?
I'm 28 now. So, it's 10 years ago.
Okay. 18 is like, fuck, man. You can't hold... I mean, I can't hold you accountable for that shit.
You can hold me accountable for still keeping it.
Oh, that's another story.
Okay, no, but it's... I think I remember, like, I think we fought or something. And she was, like, really pissed off with me. And I'm like, what do I have to do to show you my love? And she was like, I have an idea. And we went, like, some commercial street. It was a commercial street tattoo parlor. I remember that day. I remember that guy. Okay, I'm like, I selected this and I gave it to him and I'm like, I want this. The guy looks at me and goes, are you sure? This is permanent. It will stay for the rest of your life. Are you sure? I'm like, yeah, this girl I love, I will marry. Like, take. It was stuff like that. And you know, there's this, I don't know why I'm saying this, but...
Go for it, man.
Why not? It's not that bad a thing to say. I thought I had fallen in love. I still think I had.
Mm.
And we were dating and everything like that, and our parents got to know.
Okay.
And I, like a full dildar again, I went... sat in front of her father and said,
sweet,
this is the person that I love your daughter.
Damn nice.
I want to do all this. The guy's like, idella ivag bekagilla.
First,
please, both kodi. But it's okay, you can still
be friends.
Be friends and all that. No, but it's true. He was actually very nice about it.
Okay, sweet.
And, but the one condition they had was that family in Ella Tumba Vodidare, everyone's like very learned, like PhD level and all that shit. So you have to do engineering.
Okay.
I never wanted to do engineering. I was like, I wanted to do journalism. I wanted to do stuff like that. Back then, journalism was still a noble profession.
It's still, yeah.
It's not now.
Okay, we'll get into
fuck you, Arnab Goswami.
Oh,
and, you ruined it for everybody.
Oh, man.
And so I joined engineering. We both joined the same college. We were in the same class. We did all of that shit.
Okay.
And then engineering tali ghatli laguru.
Oh, okay.
It was gone. That was it was like I just kept failing and failing and
so
failing.
So this chick was your classmate also?
Yeah. Okay. And she also... with me, failed and failed and failed. We got a year back also. For those of you who don't know VTU rules, if you fail in more than 4 subjects, you have to stay back a year and like finish all of that and then come back. I managed to clear those.
Okay.
She could not.
Okay.
And so they took her out.
Okay.
And guess what they made her join?
What?
Journalism.
Oh shit.
You can't script this shit, dude. Like
it's real.
Anyway, yeah. But somehow struggled. Fucking breakup happened.
Where did you break up?
I was a chur.
Yeah, okay.
That much.
You fucked it up.
I know. I fucked it up. It was mainly me. I was like this conservative chur. Oh my god, why are you wearing short skirts? I'm like,
okay.
Why? Now when I think back on it, I'm like, what a grade A asshole I was.
Mm.
So she was right.
Okay.
In her decision. And
she's married?
No. She's now a model in Bombay.
Okay. Sweet.
Shout out to you.
Nice.
You know who you are. And
sure.
God. She's gonna hate me. But okay. Broke up, I think, during 7th semester.
Okay. So were you looking at the tattoo when you broke
depression,
up?
Bro. Full depression. Like fucking drank like I'm pretty sure I've consumed like a fucking ton of alcohol.
You know? Okay.
Like, just kept drinking. I'm like, hey, oh, and the thing was that I got like so fucking depressed because I was doing engineering on the basis that this was going to happen.
That you'll end up marrying this girl.
Huh.
Yeah, that was the main motivation.
So now the you know, like, the carrot on the stick.
Yeah, of course, I get
carrot
it.
Carrot on the stick.
No, I get it. The Yeah, yeah.
So your main motivation is gone.
Yeah. Why will you run when the carrot is missing, right?
Yeah. Got so it was like that, and I don't know, just...
Yeah, okay.
The thing of, like, bearing all this shit, it just went away. And
okay.
I was so depressed. And I told you, right, like my friend called me to do a project.
Sure.
And he was like, hey, how many languages are you proficient in? And I'm like, Hindi, Kannada, English. Like, Lord, I'm talking about programming languages. I literally realized that as a computer engineering student, I should have answered that question like that. You know, I'm like, yeah, bro, I know C, C++, Python, all that shit. No clue. I have no idea how I even made it till the 8th semester, right? And that day it was just bugging me. And I remember my parents, they were just sitting in the hall and I just walked out to them. I was so fucking nervous, but I walked out to them and I was like, listen, by this time I'd already started stand-up, by the way.
Okay, nice.
So
nice.
6 months or 7 months I'd already started.
And
imagine like going to college, where teachers are telling you that you're a dumb fuck.
Okay.
And then going to like open mics and shows where people are giving you an applause break.
Oh man. How confused are you at this point?
No, I just went up to them and I'm like, listen, I don't know, but I don't think I want to do engineering anymore.
Okay. To your parents?
Yeah. Okay. And my parents' reaction really, really surprised me.
What did they say?
They just looked at me and went, thank God you finally understood.
Oh shit, okay.
We namge depression aagta itto.
Oh, because of the breakup.
Yeah. Oh, no, I was completely like always sad all the time type.
But did they know that you were going through a breakup?
Yeah.
Okay.
My parents knew, her parents knew, everything.
Mm-hmm.
This is why you don't drink on camera. You know? This is why. Don't go out of the frame like that. Come here and accept your mistake.
Hey, this is not my water. This is my water.
At the end difference.
Boiled water.
Oh, hangi.
See the planning. First of all, throat is gone. On that drinking.
Sumne you're drinking alcohol and you want to drink it with boiled water. ಅದೇನಂತಾರೆ ವಿಷಾನ ತೋಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು ಕ್ವಾಲಿಟಿ ವಿಷ ಐ ವಾಂಟ್ ಯು ನೋ ಲೈಕ್ ಇಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಟು ಬಿ ನೈಸ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಟ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ನೋ ಲೈಕ್ ಐ ಯು ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಸ್ಮೋಕಿಂಗ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಅ ಕಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಆರ್ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ಸಮ್ ಗೈ ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಯು ಕಮ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಈಸ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಸ್ಮೋಕಿಂಗ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಪ್ಲೇಯರ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಮೈನ್ ಇಸ್ ಬೆಟರ್ ಸೀಕ್ರೆಟ್ ಬೋತ್ ಆರ್ ಗೆಟಿಂಗ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ಸರ್ ಲೈಕ್
ಐ ಕಾಂಟ್ ಡು ದಿಸ್ Oh shit, I can't do this.
Boiled water, you want? Tika boil agate, rada bedage.
Oh man, I don't know what to say anymore, bro. Oh man. Okay, coming back. I almost forgot we were still rolling. Okay, coming back. Bro, let's talk about the next ex. because I still want to know the reaction. Like, she's seeing the name on your hand. Like, how is she taking it?
No, I... Like, when she asked, like, what? I'm like, you know those old movies? Like, there'll be an old man. And they'll be like, what? Were you in Vietnam, old man? And then he'll be like, and there'll be like a scar here. And that was when a Korean slashed me. This was when like this happened. I'm like, I told her like, this is kind of like my own personal war scar. You know, man. Like, if, you know, it also holds like a thing, but I know that I fucked up. This didn't work out.
Yeah, yeah.
But also at the same time, I overcame it. So it's like a sign that it's like, it's bittersweet.
Bittersweet. Yeah, yeah, of course.
It's like a sign that...
Also the first serious relationship, I'm guessing.
Yeah, first very, very serious relationship.
Yeah, of course, you were fucking 18. And this second chick, why didn't that happen? Yes, bro.
No.
Because of this? Why?
She's like, you need to stop drinking. I'm like, then you leave.
Bro, bombs you're dropping.
It was not that simple, but technically it's that. Yeah.
Man, that's too much. That's way. How long were you with her?
4 years.
4 fucking years. What's your scene now?
Single, ready to mingle, on Tinder and on Bumble. Nobody is swiping, bro.
Nobody's swiping.
It is like so... Like, I'm like, recently happened, okay? Like, I got on Bumble and just, of course, like, everyone, right swipe. Suddenly one match happened, okay?
Okay, exciting.
Like, oh, yes! Finally, one match happened. But you have to wait for her to
make the
first
contact,
right? Now, in my bio, I had written stand-up comedian by day, writer by night, some shit, lauda lasun, I've written. And then the last line was...
That will be enough for you to get action.
But the last line was, people call me a nice guy, and as you know, nice guys finish last.
Oh, sweet.
Nice line, right?
Yeah, like, yeah, nice
if you
line.
Get it like
yeah,
a...
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Nice line.
But the problem was she replied when I was drunk.
Well.
And she's like, so nice guys finish last? Question mark. And I'm going, yeah, life is very hard for nice guys. They are not. Life is like too tough. Unmatched. Like, that was the only match I got. And then, dude, it's a game that I don't think I ever like subscribed into or I was not into when it started. So I don't know how it works now. Right? You know, I didn't maintain.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
If you see me before and after, if I'll give you like a picture, you can
put please like send it in. We'll do that.
And you can see me now.
Okay.
And you'll be like, fuck, what happened? You'll be like that. Right? So now it's too much. I can't. I quit.
Yeah, yeah. You quit trying to change.
I quit. I will make enough money and go to Amsterdam. That's all. I'm not doing this shit again.
But how do you think of a single life, man? Like, what's your thing of it?
I don't know, man.
I was actually asking you before you got distracted fucking about brutal pickups. Like, what is... Like, you know, there's this thing of when you're 40 and you're not married. Then you might just feel like, fuck, I should have just gotten married.
Do I look like 40?
No. I'm saying when you turn 40, I'm saying, and you're not fucking married and you think, shit, I should have just gotten married to someone for company. Have you thought of that situation? No.
It's different for different people, I'm sure. But
okay.
For me, I'm very okay spending time by myself.
Okay.
Like, I can, like, literally, like, sit, like... Dude, like, I can sit without anybody and I can still have, like, a conversation with myself.
Yeah, you're chill with it.
And I'm chill with it. So like I'm not, like, worried about,
lonely
like...
Lonely or fucking, like, crying about it.
It is very different when you're in a relationship and you feel lonely.
Right? Yeah, that's even tougher.
That's tougher. The best way to describe it is, what was the line? I like to be lonely around people.
You can be an observer, no?
Yeah,
that's
where
your shit happens. That's why you write your shit.
Exactly. Like, if there's a room of like 10 people, I don't mind like just standing in the corner and just watching people fuck themselves up.
Okay.
Or like if there's a player, I'm like, kudos to you. Like, you know, I like just sitting sometimes and just observing how people behave.
Mm.
And it is a curse or a boon, I don't know. But very good with that.
Are you like a hardworking guy?
No.
You're not?
Not much, no.
Do you think, say tomorrow you get like a crazy project that requires you to work your ass off for 365 days and it may set you up for the rest of your life? Do you think you'll do justice to it? Or do you think you're...
No, I'll... If it's work, I will do it.
Ah, that's what I'm asking.
But I will not do it like my life depends on it.
Okay.
You know, there's a difference there, right? There are some people who just live for the work. They don't live for themselves.
What do you do with all the money that you make apart from paying your bills?
Amsterdam.
We already
talked about that. And... Drink. Go around the world.
Do you want to travel a lot?
Everyone always keeps saying, why don't... I'm a traveler. I'm like a wanderlust person and all that shit. I'm like, I want to travel the world, but first class.
Okay.
Like, I don't want to go like backpacking, like a fucking biking.
Yeah.
All that shit, I don't...
You want to do it right.
I want to do it classy.
You think you can do it alone all by yourself? You would enjoy it?
Imagine sitting in a first class fucking thing on a plane. You're in a great hotel. Of course you can do it by yourself. Even you can. If not, I'll call you Adarsh. You and I seem
yeah,
to be
bro.
Good company.
Like,
I really like you. I've met him for the first time today. And I can clearly tell that this is going to be a long-lasting friendship. If I'm 40 and I don't have anyone, Adarsh, I'll call you.
Call me.
We'll like open up a shack in Ooty somewhere and we'll just live happily ever after. Like drinking old monk.
Chal, bro. Life's ours anyway. Tell me what, like, you know, final few things here. Like one thing you definitely want to do, man. Like before you fucking, you know, scoot from here. What is one thing you definitely want
to...
No, dude.
From life.
Yeah.
You're saying scoot from life.
Yeah.
Oh.
What's the one thing you want to have on your shit? Like, fuck, I did this in my life. Take your fucking time.
You know what? Whenever I've thought of shit like this, no, it never happens.
No, fucking think about it,
I'll
bro.
Think about it. I'll think about it. But what I'm trying to tell you is that my life's aim when I was in college or when I was in school was one the money, one the car. That too, Maruti car.
Yeah,
not even thinking like Mercedes and all
mediocre,
that shit.
One nice.
It's like a mediocre, like family, two kids, all that. Now, if you ask me, I'm like, dude, one day I just want to like walk out on the stage and have like a nice special for Netflix or like Amazon Prime or whatever has come out.
Who's your favorite comedian?
Dave Chappelle.
Oh, nice.
Of course, man. The guy is a legend, a goat.
Did you watch the latest, The Closer?
I have watched all of it, like multiple number of times. I can like quote it.
Nice.
I want that one shot in my life where I walk up on the stage, people are screaming, and the camera just turns to the audience, and you see a sea of people, you know, thousands just sitting there waiting to see me. That is the one goal.
What do you think is between you and that?
Experience.
Hmm.
You need time to hone the craft.
How long you think?
Another 20 years.
20 years.
Hopefully, if I'm alive.
I think you'll be, bro. Oh, man. Suhas, with that being said, I think this was...
Are
you feeling sad?
I am. This was fun.
Oh, man. I'm glad. No, I like the final picture that you painted. And looking forward, like, I've never seen a show of yours. I'm waiting to...
Don't. I know a lot of people will be like, please come and see. Don't.
No.
It's okay.
I'm looking forward to it.
How do you call people then? You don't know anything about them. Huh?
Like, I've just watched videos, bro. I've just watched your videos and I'm like, okay, let's do it. It's as simple as that. But anyway, thank you for being here. I hope
you
had a good
time.
Thank
you so much for having me on your show and it was a great experience.
Okay.
And here's to being drinking buddies in the future.
Cheers, man.
I mean, even today, we're continuing after this, okay? If you guys don't know. See you soon at a venue near you.
Oh, man. So thank you so much. This was Suhas Navratna. We had a great time. This was episode 20 of On a Personal Note with Adarsh Sakre. See you on the next one. Thank you, guys.